Buongiorno e come stai tutti? The National Italian American Foundation Gala Dinner, October 30th, 1994, in Washington, D.C. Folks, this is part two, and I really and truly hope that you got a chance to see part one, because it was just a fantastic 2 days. Io sono Kita Valentino e questa è Casa e Cucina. Sit back and enjoy a great Italian American show.
Una bella voce, siamo una bella voce. Insieme una bella voce, siamo una bella voce, gente italiana. Lavoriamo, mangiamo, beviamo, cantiamo, balliamo, festeggiamo insieme una bella voce, siamo una bella.
Thank you. Did we pass the family leave bill or didn't we? Did we do this or that specific thing? But it's also a spirit. And it has to pervade people in their lives. It has to reach down deep into them in order for us to do what we can do. This nation has never been made great primarily by its government. Its government has to reflect the greatness, the energy, the direction of the people. And leadership in a democracy like ours is possible only insofar as it is connected to what is profoundly good and enduring, but also open to change in America. The greatest thing about this country is, and the reason we're still around after more than 200 years, is that we have been rooted to a set of constitutional values and principles, rooted in the deep philosophical conviction that each and every one of us is a creature of God, entitled to be treated equally before the law, entitled to be challenged and given the opportunity to live up to the fullest of our God-given capacities. That is what has kept us going. And rooted to those things, we have been free, therefore, to change over and over and over again with every age and time to meet whatever challenges we face. The freedom to change because we were rooted in these values, and they were enshrined in our Constitution, and we were willing to fight and die for them. That is what has kept us here as the longest-lasting free government in all of human history. It is a magical thing. Now, if you look at the problems we have today, they largely grow out of a curious combination of our refusal to adapt to the challenges of today and tomorrow, and our violation of the traditional values which got us where we are. And so I say, as you look toward the future, we have to do something that you may think is contradictory, but is not contradictory at all. We have to do the basic things better, and we have to be better at facing our problems and turning them into a promise and being agents of change. Consider the problems of America. For 30 years, we have had increasingly difficult social problems, all starting with the breakdown of the solidity of the family, the institution which made most Italian Americans what they are today, and the rest of us as well. Then the breakdown of the sense of community and the other institutions of community, and the availability of work without which life does not have sufficient dignity. And all the things we don't like, the drugs, the gangs, the guns, the violence, the deterioration of the ability of our young people to exercise discipline and self-control. All of the bad things we don't like were created because of the vacuum which existed from the absence of the good things. Now, this did not happen overnight. It has been a generation in coming, and it will not turn around overnight. Your government has certain responsibilities in the crime bill to empower communities to hire more police and to defend themselves and to make the schools safer and to do more about violence within the families and to protect victims and all the things we try to do in the crime bill and dealing with the assault weapons. But a lot of this has to be done at the grassroots level. Where communities and police work together, the crime rate goes down. There are many cities in this country where for 3 years running now, we've had double-digit reductions in the crime rate. In every case, it was because of what people did where they live and work, not because of something that happened up here. We have empowered people to drive down crime and lift up kids, but they must do it. You must do it. And in the end, all of these young people who are going astray have got to have somebody to look up to again. They have got to have somebody to look up to again. Did you ask yourselves what in God's name was going on in the minds of those kids that dropped the five-year-old from the high rise in Chicago? What turns the heart of a 10-year-old to stone? Everybody in this world is going to look up to someone. Who is it going to be? What will they stand for? At the end of this congressional session, a bill little noticed and barely commented on, sponsored by the retiring senator from Ohio, Howard Metzenbaum, passed the Congress. A bill to make it easier for Americans to adopt children without families across racial lines. It was just a small step. But I hope and pray this is something we'll be able to get together people across racial lines, across religious lines, across political party lines. I am telling you, these little kids are going to look up to somebody or something. They're either going to watch 4 hours of television at night with people with violent behavior providing cheap thrills, where the future is what happens in 5 minutes, not 10 years, or somebody is going to be putting a hand on them and showing them a different way. And the Italian-American community can have a major impact on our ability to lift the children of America, to turn around a 30-year trend and push it back the other way. For all the modernization of America, if we continue to allow the brutalization of childhood for millions of our kids, we will not have what we need to have. And that is the fact. If you look at the economy, you find a different set of challenges. For 20 years, more or less, although there's some indication the trend may finally be changing this year, for 20 years, more or less, hourly wage earners have not gotten a raise. The average working family spending more hours at work in 1994 than in 1969, 25 years ago. Why? Well, there are lots of reasons. But most of it, I'm convinced, is the globalization of the economy, the globalization of wage rates, the fact that every job and every investment now has to be considered in terms of all the pressures all around the world, and our failure to adapt to those changes. Why is America coming back? Because the private sector is adapting. The United States car companies in 1994, sold more automobiles than the automobile companies of Japan for the first time since 1979. This year. We had 110 months of manufacturing job growth for the first time in 10 years. For the first time in 9 years, the annual vote of international economists said America had the most productive economy in the world. Why? Because we were prepared to change. And now we have to do more of that. We have to make some changes if this economy is going to work right. We have to move people who are dependent on welfare to work through welfare reform. We have to provide people. We have to provide for a lifetime of education and training. The average 18-year-old will change jobs 6 times in a lifetime. Sooner or later, in some way that people trust, they don't think it's too dominated by the government, we've got to face the health care crisis. Another million Americans lost their health insurance this year, and they were in working families. They were not on welfare, they were working families. But if you tell me what the answer is, I can tell you that this year, for the first time in 25 years, your government reduced both defense and domestic spending. First domestic spending reduction in 25 years, even though we increased investment in education. The only thing that increased was health care costs. They're exploding. We spend 14% of our income on it. Nobody else spends more than 10%, and yet we've got 40 million people without insurance, and the 85% with insurance, almost all are at risk of losing it sometime in their lifetime. Now, if you didn't like what I tried to do, you tell me what we ought to do, but I'll tell you this, we have got to face this challenge. Bearing our head in the sand, we are not. And I'm not. violate our values. We have new challenges where we have to change, and we have to do both. One last thing I'd like to say is, I believe most of the problems we face today do not have an easy partisan division. If you define it in terms of the rhetoric that has dominated our politics for the last 20 years. And I just want to say, since one of them is here today, the more we can have partnership instead of partisanship, the better this country is going to be. I want to thank good Republicans like Congresswoman Connie Morell, who's here, and Mayor Rensi for their support. So, you know, I always like to speak here because you're so enthusiastic. I promised I wouldn't talk very long, and I know I'm a little tired. Tomorrow, Hillary will watch this on film and tell me how to talk too long. But I want to say one thing. A reasonably famous Italian, Niccolo Machiavelli, whom Leon can read without benefit of translation, said 500 years ago, there is nothing so difficult in all of human affairs than to change the established order of things. For all people who will be discomfited by the change will immediately oppose you, and those who will be benefited will be lukewarm because they are uncertain of the result. Based on the last 2 years, I'd say you're a pretty smart fellow. I ask you to remember that again, because the secret of our successes today are rooted, once again, I say again, if you look at Haiti, if you look at the Gulf, in both cases, a part of that story is something that you hardly ever read about. Our ability to perform well in Haiti, our ability to move in the Gulf, in part represented the success of American military strategy in the last 2 years, learning from the Gulf War, increasing our ability to coordinate our military efforts and to move more quickly. Change. Change in the service of traditional American values of freedom and democracy, and prosperity and security. If you look at why our economy is growing today, it's because we got the deficit down, we got our house in order, we began to invest in America again, and the private sector changed to become more competitive. Old-fashioned values, commitment to change. That is what you represent. That's what your foundation's activities represent. That's what your personal stories represent. So I say again, I wish every one of you could have been with us in the Middle East. I wish you could have looked into the faces of those people. I wish you could see this country as others see it. One of the reasons I think that immigrant families in the first or second generation are so often the most patriotic of Americans is that they still have a collective memory of America from the outside in as well as from the inside out. Century is the greatest country on earth, and I am convinced our best days are still ahead of us. We must lend a ferocious devotion to the institutions of family and work and community and to the values of our Constitution and the integrity of the individual in this country with a relentless willingness to change, to do whatever it takes to develop and empower the capacities of our people to do well in an increasingly interdependent world. We must stand up for what we believe abroad, because it makes us more secure, but every day we have to first stand up for what we believe at home. You can lead the way. Thank you, and God bless you all.
Thank you.
folks, here I am back in the hotel room, and I'm tuckered. But what a beautiful weekend that I had. You know, I'm really glad that I came here to Washington, D.C. to see the National Italian-American Foundation's dinner banquet gala. It was just a fantastic event. I'm tuckered, and I'm ready to come back to St. Louis, but not before I tell you that I really met some very special people this weekend. A lot of people, a lot of Italian-Americans in this country, the United States of America, are very, very much proud of their heritage and their culture. And this is one of the things I talk about on Casa e Cucina all the time, but bring your family-owned businesses. And you can really see it out here, folks. I met people from all over this country, Louisiana, Illinois, just about every state in the Union, and even states that I didn't even know had an Italian community. You know, sometimes we think we live in our own little world. Even on the plane on the way out here, you know, I was looking out the window and I said, boy, there's plenty of room for everyone. And listening to President Clinton's speech tonight, I couldn't help but think that, you know, this is this country that we live in, this beautiful country that we live in, that is riddled with all kinds of problems. Whether we have a Republican president or a Democrat president, we find things to say about them and just bash away, even as that the wife, you know, doesn't make any difference whether it was Reagan or Bush or Carter or Nixon or Kennedy or Eisenhower, and it probably goes all the way back to George Washington. Why anyone would want to become president, I'll never know. But you know, as leader of our country, we have to stand behind them, whether we like them or we don't like them or whatever. We have to show these other countries around the world that we do this. And we can disagree with the president of the United States, but we stand behind our leader of our country. Here's a guy that goes over to the Middle East, and for whatever reasons you want to think he went over to the Middle East far, he comes back to the United States and he gets shot at. You know, hey, think about it. You know, we really have to get our act together. We really have to watch ourselves. You know, usually Casa e Cucina is a pretty, I like to keep it light and joke around and have a good time, and sometimes we get pretty serious on the show. But after what I saw this weekend in Washington, D.C., I can't wait to get back to St. Louis to really put some shows out, some good, great cooking shows with some recipes that have been handed down from generation to generation, some interviews, lots of music, the beautiful clubs that we have in St. Louis, and tours of a lot of family-owned businesses. So, listen, I hope you enjoyed the show. The National Italian-American Foundation out in Washington, D.C., makes me one proud heck of a guy, I tell you. So, until next time, se ci vediamo dopo, arrivederci. Ciao.
Ehi, dove è andato il signor Keith? Keith, dove sei andato?
Che sei dice Luigi?
Come sta, signor Keith?
What's going on?
Oh. What is going on? Tutto bene.
Tutto bene, huh?
Sì.
Aspetta, this is the my show. You gotta go home. Is that right, Luigi?
Sì, signore. Se avete ragione, io vado a casa, sì.
That's all right. Arrivederci. Take care to everybody. Ciao.
Ciao, arrivederci. Ciao, ciao. Fate una bella giornata.